And if, just take a look at the ground, what I call the ground cloud. So in the sequence, in the gradual sequence, or the unfolding sequence of the sutta, this verse relates to what I call preparations. So you can recite it first in Pali and then in English. Bahu sachancha sipancha.
Bahu sachancha sipancha.
Vinayo cha susikito.
Vinayo cha susikito.
Subhasita chayavacha.
Subhasita chayavacha.
Etam mangalam uttamam.
Etam mangalam uttamam.
And in the English is abundant learning.
Abundant learning.
Skill in a craft.
Skill in a craft.
Being well trained in discipline.
Being well trained in discipline.
And well spoken speech.
And well spoken speech.
This is the highest blessing.
This is the highest blessing.
Okay, so we can see that this aspect is sort of, we can imagine like this is like a young person who has now come under the influence of the wise, is showing honor to those worthy of honor and has set themselves on the right course, and now they're sort of preparing themselves for a position in life. So this involves learning. We could say that this is, in modern terms, this would be obtaining a good education, then learning some kind of skill, trade, profession, with which one can earn a living. Okay, so those take care of, we might call, the practical side of life. But it's not enough just to have those practical skills so that one could succeed, for example, in earning a living. But one also needs some kind of code of moral discipline to guide one in living one's life. Probably that would, implicitly, it would be the five precepts. I should mention that usually the word vinaya is used specifically to refer to the monastic discipline. So we have in the Tripitaka, the three baskets of the teaching, the vinaya pitaka, which is taken to be the basket or collection of discipline, and it refers there specifically to monastic discipline. But it seems to me, this is my own personal opinion, that if we look at the way the sutta is unfolding, at this point, bringing in monastic discipline doesn't seem to work very well. Because we haven't even gotten our, sort of the person who's following this route, this course of training, we haven't even gotten this person into married life. We haven't tied that person down with a wife and children. So monastic discipline doesn't seem to be appropriate at this point. So I interpret here the word vinaya in a very broad sense as being a kind of code of discipline that one could use to guide oneself while one is, after one has finished one's learning or along with one's learning and training in a craft. Then well-spoken speech, I mean, this is a factor of human life. It plays an extremely important role. You know, so much, you could say, so much even of human society, our whole collective destiny, is affected by speech. And so we could say how the Buddha intuited that back, you know, centuries, many centuries ago, by giving emphasis again and again on committing oneself to right speech, to speak properly. And so we have a number of suttas that deal with right speech. Okay, so we have here, for example, one sutta which says that When speech possesses four factors, it is well spoken, not badly spoken, it is blameless and irreproachable by the wise. And here the Buddha is referring to a monk, so he says, what are the four? So here a monk speaks only what is well spoken. I have to say, that seems a bit redundant or tautological, doesn't it? Somehow I think, it seems to me almost as though the sutta has gotten maybe a little bit corrupted. No, seriously. Because if I'm saying this is well-spoken speech, it has four factors. What are the four factors? Here, one speaks only what is well-spoken. It's sort of defining the term to be defined in terms of itself. So one speaks only what is well-spoken, not what is badly spoken. One speaks only Dhamma, not a non-Dhamma. So this is the guidance for a monastic person. So of course, when there are practical necessities, then you have to speak about other things. But the point is to avoid just letting one's speech wander into idle chatter and gossip. One speaks only what is pleasing, not what is pleasing. I have a little doubt about that. Because we'll see when we come to the Buddha's speech, he doesn't always speak what is pleasing. But when it's necessary, sometimes one has to speak what is disagreeable to others, if one has their well-being in mind, their benefit in mind. So one will speak to benefit them. But if somebody is doing something wrong and you have to criticize them, then you criticize them, even if it's disagreeable and displeasing to them. But one has to do it with the right attitude of mind and with the right purpose. Okay, so one speaks only what is pleasing, not what is pleasing. One speaks only what is true, not lies. Okay, there's another sutta on right speech. And this is the kind of right speech that's appropriate, I believe, in a situation where one has to criticize somebody. So he says that, so what are the five factors that make up right speech? It is spoken at the proper time. Okay, so it is spoken at the proper time. You say not at the wrong time. So if, say, somebody is doing something wrong and you want to criticize them, and this is a situation that arises quite often in monastic life, when a teacher sees that his pupils are doing something wrong, or one sees a fellow monk doing something wrong, and one wants to point it out, sort of to correct them, to criticize them. You don't go when they're sitting at a table chatting to their friends, sort of don't barge in and say, I want to talk to you about something, and then start berating them in the presence of their friends. Because it embarrasses them, it hurts their feelings, and humiliates them in the presence of others. So you have to wait, or if they're busy working at some important job, you know, something that has to be done at a particular time, preparing lunch for a meal of 20 people, and the time is running low, you don't come over and say, let me talk to you, and then start berating the person while they're in the midst of their work. But you have to find the time when the person is alone, or you can get the person alone, and when they're not engaged in some vital activity, and then sit them down and speak to them. That is the right time. Okay, so then, if one is going to speak to them, to criticize them, you have to be sure that what you're going to speak to them about, to criticize them about, is true. And what one finds in the Vinaya, the monastic discipline, time and again, some group of monks will come to the Buddha and then they complain about the behavior of such and such a monk, that this monk is doing something that's improper for a monk. Okay. So the Buddha then will ask the monks, go call that monk, bring him to me. Okay, when they bring that monk to the Buddha doesn't start right away by criticizing the monk. But the first thing he says is, first, he repeats the report to the monk. It said that you have been... playing in the water with the little kids in ways that are sort of a little bit not proper for the monk. So say, then they'll ask, is it true? And then of course a person who's brought before the Buddha, he's not going to lie and prevaricate and wind around the subject, but almost always he'll say, yes, venerable, that's true. Then the Buddha will criticize him. Okay, so first you have to find out and make sure that the report is true. Don't start criticizing people based on rumors. Don't start spreading rumors. Okay, then when one speaks to the person, one speaks gently, not harshly, not roughly. But you have to have some kind of respect for the feelings of that person. So you want to make that person feel comfortable, and you want that person to place trust in you if you're going to speak to them. So in order to win the trust of that person, you speak gently. Then the person will know that you have a soft and gentle mind, a kind mind, and want to help them. So you speak gently, then you speak what is beneficial. So you speak intending to promote the benefit of that person, with the good of that person in mind. You don't criticize the person just to knock them down, to hurt their feelings, to humiliate them, so they go back to their room and then they feel miserable. But you want to point out the fault of the person, if necessary, show them the consequences of their behavior, and then steer them in the right direction. And then probably most important is that when you speak to the person, you do it with metta citta, a mind of loving kindness. So you really want to promote the well-being of that person. So that even first, you just, for a few moments, you just sort of fall back into the mind of loving kindness and generate the wish, may this person be well and happy. Then you start speaking. Then the Buddha's speech. Okay, the sutra goes through various permutations. Okay, so one is something that's untrue or incorrect, unbeneficial, and it's disagreeable to others. So we have actually three factors being woven together here. Whether something is true or untrue, unbeneficial or beneficial, and disagreeable or agreeable to others. So this speech, the Buddha doesn't speak on all three grounds. Then there's speech that the Buddha knows to be true, but unbeneficial and disagreeable to others. That speech the Buddha doesn't utter. Then there's speech that he knows to be true, correct, and beneficial, but which is disagreeable to others. So here he says, he knows the time to use such speech. So if he has to speak in ways that are disagreeable, he's not going to restrain from that speech. He'll use it when necessary, but under the proper circumstances. Okay, then incorrect and so on, unbeneficial. And what if it's, yeah, if some speech is false, unbeneficial, but it's agreeable to others, flattering others, just to please them. He doesn't utter such speech. The speech he knows to be true, correct, but unbeneficial, and which is welcome and agreeable to others, he doesn't utter. So speech that he knows to be true and beneficial, and which is welcome and agreeable to others, he knows the proper time to use such speech. So these practices of the Buddha are somewhat like guidelines for us to use when we have to speak to others. So make sure that what we are saying is true. Make sure that it is beneficial to others, and that we're uttering the speech with the intent to benefit others. Then whether the speech is disagreeable to others or agreeable to others, we should still utter that speech, but do so under the right conditions at the right time. Okay, now that we have gone through this education for training, we have the code of discipline, well-spoken speech, now we come to the section called Leading a Virtuous Life in the World. And the first verse is dealing with family responsibilities. So let us go back to the sutta. Okay, again, we'll recite both in Pali and in English. Mata pitu upatanam.
Mata pitu upatanam.
Puta darasa sangaho.
Puta darasa sangaho.
Anakula chakamanta.
Anakula chakamanta.
Etang mangalam uttamam.
Etang mangalam uttamam.
Okay, then the English translation of before we come to that, I have to say that this is characteristic of all of the Buddha's, or most of the Buddha's discourses. I feel a little apologetic about that nowadays, but they're spoken from almost like from the standpoint that the male is sort of the subject of the discourse. And so here too we find, okay, so the Buddha is giving the advice to the man, but we can maybe make it gender neutral. So we'll, instead of wife, I'll use the word spouse. Okay, to support one's father and mother.
To support one's father and mother.
To maintain one's spouse and children.
To maintain one's spouse and children.
And to be engaged in a harmless occupation.
And to be engaged in a harmless occupation.
This is the highest blessing.
This is the highest blessing.
Okay, so here we have the emphasis is on family responsibilities. And so first, supporting one's mother and father and honoring one's mother and father. This is a virtue on which the Buddha placed, again, a lot of emphasis. Okay, and this is a sutta that I find very, very deeply meaningful and even inspiring. So the Buddha first, he says that there are two people that are not easily repaid. What are the two? Who are the two? One's mother and one's father. Then he says, even if one should carry one's mother on one shoulder, the father on the other shoulder, and they should live 100 years, still one would not be doing enough to repay the kindness of one's parents. Why is that? Because parents are a great help to their children. They bring them up, feed them, and show them the world. And just if we stop at this point, like one thing that I've learned many times here in the United States, and I know people have sometimes very difficult relationships with their parents. You know, Buddhist texts always say respect your parents, be kind to your parents, have friendly relations with your parents. But very often, very sadly, parents are either abusive to their children, or they neglect their children, they're rough with their children, they beat their children in ways that are very painful. And so relationships between children, us, and our parents sometimes can be very difficult and very, very painful. So the question comes, how does one relate to one's parents? How does one fulfill one's obligations under those circumstances? So what I say is that under such circumstances, even though one might bear a lot of painful memories from one's relations with one's parents, but one should remember that I don't want to absolve anybody completely from responsibility, but often it's because the parents themselves, one's own parents, have been living under stressful conditions. They have a lot of scars, mental scars, that they've inherited from an earlier generation, from their parents, from things that happened in their lives. And sadly, they take it out on their children. And so if one reflects in that way, that then one can develop compassion towards one's parents and try to, assuming your parents are still alive and you're in that situation, make them objects of a meditation on loving kindness and compassion, and try to put oneself in their shoes and their clothes and generate that heart of kindness and compassion towards them. And I don't want to promise miracles to anybody, but sometimes doing that can subtly change the mindset of one's parents. It could happen either when you come into direct contact with them. You know, if the parents are rough and abusive, abrasive towards you, and then you respond in the same way, you become aggressive and criticize your parents in return and shout at them and yell at them, then it just inflames the situation. And so the tensions become tighter and tighter, the relationship deteriorates. But if you can just put all of your past resentment aside and just direct that mind of loving kindness towards your parents when you're in their presence, it might have a transformative effect on them. And even doing it from a distance without being in their presence, I believe, this is my personal belief, that there's sort of subtle interconnections between, maybe you call this like a psychic order, a mental order, which is not immediately visible, so that we're connected by these deep underlying webs of connectedness directly from mind to mind without even having to be physically present to another person. So I think if you're directing loving kindness towards that other person from the distance without being in their presence, when you come into their presence, their attitude can be very different from the way it was in the past. Just through the power of the mind that you've developed with your own, you know, when you're in your own private space. And then there's, the Buddha continues in the sutta by explaining how one can return the kindness of one's parents. Here he says, one who encourages his unbelieving parents settles and establishes them in faith. And this doesn't mean that you go to your parents and start preaching Buddhism. But sometimes you have to use like subtle, skillful means to turn the mind around. And if you start preaching Buddhism to your parents and they are if they're followers of another religion, staunch followers of another religion, you don't want to get into an interreligious warfare at home. And if they're not following any religion, but they're committed to their kind of skepticism or agnosticism, again, you don't want to create conflict by preaching to them. But sometimes you can find like little openings to gradually transform them. I know I used to have a very, very difficult relationship with, well, first my mother was always very unhappy that I became a monk, even though formally they gave me permission and that they said, at that time I think I was 26, 27, so they said, it's your life, you have to make your own choice, we can't stop you. But please, don't go. Wasn't there some baby, please don't go? Yeah, so my mother was so sad, and my father was so angry, and he actually read quite a bit on Buddhism, and he would pull out all of the little bits and pieces that he found objectionable in Buddhism. Like there's a passage like in the Dhammapada about one of the early verses, that one who dwells contemplating the impurities. And then I think maybe it was Venerable Narada's translation in which he had notes to the verses. And the notes said that here the monk practices contemplating the corpse and different stages of disintegration. And so my father said, is that what you are doing in Sri Lanka? Is this the religion you chose to follow? You're sitting there contemplating a corpse disintegrating? Okay, but if you see that the parents are open, if you find like some point of contact, like you could provide some, at least some little Dhamma books that will deal with maybe more the ethical aspects of Buddhism, that in which they could get a foothold, and then maybe gradually they will develop, even if they don't develop faith, at least they'll develop some understanding and acceptance of it. Like later on, over time, I don't know whether this happened because the power of my loving kindness had become so strong or because my parents softened and with their age, but my mother became much more accepting and she passed away in 2002. No, it was 2001 she passed away. And then my father continued to live on till he was almost 99 years old. And then we had quite a cordial, friendly relationship, even though I didn't think, I didn't quite win him to the faith. But he became somewhat proud of me. And, you know, okay, so one settles the parents in faith, encourages the immoral parents, establishes them in sila, in good conduct. If the parents are miserly, one establishes them in generosity. If the parents are ignorance, one establishes them in wisdom. And then the Buddha says, such a one does enough for his parents. He repays them and more than repays them for what they have done. Okay, then we have husbands and wives. And again, one finds quite a few suttas or discourses in which the Buddha deals with marital relations. And in my early days, when I was just becoming acquainted with Buddhism and reading in Buddhism, of course I was attracted to the more philosophical teachings and then the meditative practices. But then I came across the suttas in which the Buddha explains to children how to relate to their parents how to relate to their children, and husbands, how to relate to their wives and wives to their husbands. And this impressed me so much. It was quite astonishing to see that somebody who could have reached what we call like the deepest level of enlightenment, the highest realization of enlightenment, doesn't lose touch with humanity and just becomes an ascetic, preaching renunciation, give up the pleasures of the senses, go into the homeless life, meditate on the 32 repulsive parts of the body, develop revulsion and dispassion towards the world and break all of your bondage and get liberated. But he does teach those things, but he also teaches people living in the world how they can live in the world in a way that's grounded in the Dhamma, that's sustained by the Dhamma, that will gradually lift them up from stage to stage so that they too can reach liberation. So here he speaks about four kinds of marriages. So he speaks about a wretch living together with a wretch. By a wretch, actually, the word that's used in Pali, I think, means something like a corpse. I thought that it sounded a little bit odd in English to use that word, so I use a wretch. This is a wretch with a goddess, and God lives with a wretch, and the god lives together with a goddess. I think we could just take the best of the four possibilities. Okay, so this is the way a god lives together with a goddess. So the husband is one who abstains from the destruction of life. This is observing the five precepts. He is virtuous, of good character, that comes from observing the precepts. And he is one who is generous. He lives at home with a heart free from the stain of miserliness. He's openly generous. And he doesn't abuse or revile ascetics and Brahmins. And then his wife is exactly the same in all respects. So that is what the Buddha is holding up as the ideal type of marriage. Yeah, actually there are other suttas, I think that I have them in notes, in which the Buddha speaks more about marital relations. Oh yeah, he's speaking about the duties of a husband towards his wife. And he speaks about five duties. And he says that the husband should be courteous to the wife. He should show her respect, should be faithful to her, give her authority in the management of the household, and then he should give her gifts of clothing and jewelry from time to time. What is so funny?
I should have brought my husband.
What is that?
I should have brought my husband.
But this is very, very incisive when you look at this against the sort of prevalent view in Indian society as inscribed in the laws of Manu. This is like the formal code of discipline for those who follow Brahmanism or Hinduism. The husband has almost like absolute authority over the wife, and the wife just has to be in a very servile position, serving her husband. So the Buddha established almost a relationship of equality between husband and wife. Okay, then the wife has certain duties towards her husband. She should see to the proper care of the household. Well, she should be cordial to her in-laws, because what happens in Indian society, when the man gets married, then the wife goes to live, they have extended families, so the wife goes to live with the family of her husband. I think that was unavoidable in ancient India. Today would be very different. So the wife should be cordial to the in-laws, she should be faithful, she should take good care of the family wealth. So the husband, in this conception, earns the wealth, turns it over to his wife, and she manages the wealth. And then she should be skillful and diligent in fulfilling her duties. Then there are duties that the parents have towards their children, that the parents should guide the children by morally, by restraining them from evil, encouraging them to do good by personal example as well as by precept. They should provide or oversee the education of their children. They should ensure that their child chooses a suitable marriage partner. Well, in ancient India, and even today, there are arranged marriages. Even in Sri Lanka, a Buddhist country, today there are arranged marriages. In my mischievous moments in Sri Lanka, you see, in the Sunday newspaper, they have marriage proposals. And so the parents would put, usually it's the parents of the daughter would put the proposal in the newspaper. Sometimes even the parents of the son would put the proposal in the newspaper. So you say a certain family is seeking a partner for our well-educated son, 32 years old. And then they'll give some other qualifications. Okay, choose a suitable marriage partner, then hand over the inheritance to the children at the proper time. Okay, and I want to move now into the next line in this, the verse that we're taking, and that is earning a living by a harmless occupation. So this takes us into the sphere of right livelihood. And so here we'll just treat this briefly and say that the Buddhist, when he speaks about right livelihood, he says that the lay follower should not engage in five kinds of trades. So he speaks of trading in weapons, very big industry today. Trading in living beings, and that would include trading in human beings, being involved in the slave trade, and also maybe human trafficking. And also include trading in animals, like raising animals for slaughter and then selling them to, you know, to the butchers for slaughter. Then trading in meat, trading in intoxicants, selling intoxicating substances, and trading in poisons. Trading in poisons that with the intention that the poisons are going to be used to poison other people. I mean, nowadays there are so many substances that are poisonous, but they're not intentionally produced for poisoning people.
That was an industry back then? Was there a poison industry in ancient India?
I guess that there were people who manufactured poisons.
Why drugs?
There still is.
Yeah.
There still is.
Drug dealers.
Sure. No, like roach motels, for example.
Like?
Insecticides.
I guess those would be considered poisons, yeah. I was thinking more of poisoning human beings. Okay, now we'll move on to the next verse. So this is what I call, I've given it the title, Becoming a Pillar of Society. So this is sort of extending one's sphere of concern beyond that of just the narrow confines of one's family, but extending it to others in society. Okay, so again, we can go through both the Pali and the English translation. Oh, I see. Okay. Dhanancha Dhammacharyacha.
Dhanancha Dhammacharyacha.
Nyatakanancha Sangaho.
Nyatakanancha Sangaho.
Anavajani Kamani.
Anavajani Kamani.
Etang Mangalamuttamam.
Etang Mangalamuttamam.
And then the English, generosity and righteous conduct.
Generosity and righteous conduct.
Rendering assistance to relatives.
Rendering assistance to relatives.
And performance of blameless actions.
And performance of blameless actions.
This is the highest blessing.
This is the highest blessing.
Okay, so we start off here with the word dana, which means the act, literally it's the act of giving. But what lies behind the act of giving is the mental state, to a mental quality of generosity. So technically, what we call generosity is rendered by it corresponds to a different Pali word, which is chaga, sort of giving up, that attitude of giving up. And then when that attitude of giving or generosity comes expressed in action, then it becomes dana. So this becomes a way to show that one extends one's concern beyond oneself, beyond those who are directly related to oneself, and one is sort of opening one's heart to the needs of others by finding what others need and then providing for their needs. And there are countless ways of practicing dana or generosity in our lives today. So, maybe a little advertisement for the center, but one of the ways is by supporting the center, supporting other temples, monasteries, where the Dhamma is being taught. You know, because it's a principle of the Buddha's way of teaching is that the Dhamma should be given free of charge, without any charge. And so, monastics always have subsisted independence on the generosity of the lay community. So this is a very beautiful practice established in the Asian Buddhist countries. So there's never any kind of charges for Dhamma teaching, and the monks and nuns depend for their food, their dwelling places, their robes, on the generosity of the lay community. So just about everything that you find in a monastery has been offered by lay people, either directly or providing funds for the purchase of those items. Sometimes I have to say, a little critically, no, seriously, that it's carried to extremes so that, because it's considered very meritorious to offer, say, robes to monks, that the monastery cupboard gets overstuffed with robes. And people will give the robes over and over, even though there might be five monks living in the monastery. And nowadays, these robes last a long time. So I've had robes now that I've been using for, I think, one robe for about eight, nine years. Somehow it just doesn't wear out. But the one thing that always has to be renewed every day is food. And then, of course, monastics will need some kind of medical care, at least medical insurance. So these are things to provide to support the monastery. Another way of sort of practicing generosity and helping to spread the Dhamma is to purchase like Dhamma books or to contribute to the printing of Dhamma books and then distribute those Dhamma books. So even if you find in your local library that there are no copies of the Buddha's discourses, you could, first you have to inquire from them whether you would accept those volumes. And then if they would accept, then you can purchase a set of the books and offer them to the library. And this way you're contributing, not only practicing Dana directly by giving something, but you're making the Dhamma available indirectly to. You don't know how many people are going to read those books and then get inspired and then seek out the Buddha Center and then become involved with the Dhamma. And then aspects of generosity that should not be forgotten, and that is the need to help people who are in serious need, people who are afflicted by war. So there are organizations that are providing like medical assistance to people in war-torn countries, particularly Doctors Without Borders. And there's another one based in Los Angeles. Gee, I forgot the name, but they also do similar work to Doctors Without Borders. Organizations that are providing food to the needy people, that are helping with development to develop poor countries that they can raise their standard of living. So there are many, many ways of practicing generosity, and we can regard these as a way of expressing, I call it compassion in action, sort of opening one's hearts to the needs, the suffering of others, and then helping to relieve that suffering by giving and giving generously. And what one finds, you know, there's a natural tendency in the mind to hold on to what we possess and think we create these boundaries. This is mine, that's yours. It's terrible in this country that they have. I think the whole legal system revolves around the right to property. So everything is claimed with, this is mine. Copyright, licenses, trademarks. If you overstep the boundary a little, you're facing a lawsuit from powerful corporations. But the practice of generosity is a way of breaking down these barriers and sort of recognizing that we really all exist together in this intricate network of mutual support. And so this is affirming the, call it the integral interrelatedness of all the human beings, all sentient beings, all entities within that web of existence. Okay, then there are some suttas that speak about generosity. Okay, so this is just like the standard or stock passage on the practice of generosity. So here the word used is actually chaga. So what is accomplishment in generosity? Here a noble disciple dwells at home with a mind free from the stain of miserliness, freely generous, open-handed, delighting in relinquishment, devoted to charity, delighting in giving and sharing. And significant that the text uses the word delighting, because what one finds when one starts to practice generosity and giving is that it gives an inner joy, a kind of warm, swelling inner joy, which to the extent that one practices giving, that sense of joy, that inner, like a ball of warmth, starts to grow stronger and stronger, become brighter and brighter, and the mind becomes happier and happier. So that as one practices giving, just always the mind is sort of flooded with joy. And then when one goes back sort of into one's seclusion and reflects on the generosity, again that joy will swell up again. So the Buddha, actually amongst the different subjects of meditation, one of the subjects of meditation is actually the recollection of generosity. So when you practice generosity, then you don't finish it with the act of giving, but you go back to reflect on it, not, you know, to think how great I am, how wonderful I am. Maybe people should erect a plaque to my name and put it up on a building someplace or the public square. But just one sees how beautiful the quality generosity is. And then the Buddha says that as one reflects in this way on generosity, the mind calms down, greed, hate, and delusion subside, joy arises, and then building on that joy, the mind can move towards samadhi, towards concentration. So there's a kind of samadhi that arises based on the recollection of generosity. Anguttara Nikaya, Book of Sixes, Sutta number 10. I think it's also, again, in Book of Sixes, Sutta number 22, somewhere in that area. Okay, so here the Buddha says that if people knew, as I know, the result of giving and sharing, they would not eat without having given, nor would they allow the stain of miserliness to take root in their minds. Even if they were down to their last morsel, their last mouthful, they would not eat without having shared it if there was somebody present to receive it. So that is a material gift. But then the Buddha speaks about two kinds of gifts, the gift of material goods and the gift of the Dhamma. Then he says of these two, the gift of the Dhamma is foremost. But when he says that, I always have to put like a little footnote to it, because some people then jump to the conclusion, it's enough just to give the gift of the Dhamma, we can neglect the gift of material things. But we have to remember that material things are necessary for people to survive and to thrive. And so one gives material things that will help, especially help people who are in trouble, in poverty, or with illness, with injury, and so on. Give them the care that they need. That is extremely essential, indispensable. Okay, then the next factor mentioned is righteous conduct. Dhammacharya. So, in itself, it's a very broad term, since everything that we're doing is, in a way, living in accordance with Dhamma. But the commentary, in order to give this a more specific content, explains it as the 10 types of wholesome action. So in the morning, one of the participants asked, how do we know, like, what is right? What is right conduct? So it's very useful about the Buddha's teaching. Sometimes it's a little frustrating. Like when we see the sayings of Jesus, they're not formulated numerically, but often they're very pungent and punchy. Whereas sometimes the teachings of the Buddha could be a little tedious because they come so often in these forms of lists. But the lists always serve as very, very precise and reliable guidelines to conduct. And so we find this here in regard to righteous conduct, that bringing in the commentary, it says, we could understand this as the 10 courses of wholesome conduct, which are mentioned again and again in the sutras. So the, whoops. See them all together. Okay, so we have three of body, three guidelines for bodily action, to abstain from, and each has a negative aspect and a positive aspect. So one abstains from killing and dwells compassionate towards all beings. Abstains from stealing, and instead one lives honestly and becomes trustworthy, worthy of the trust of others. One abstains from sexual misconduct, and then if one is in a relationship, one remains faithful to one's partner, exercising restraint. Of course, if one is a monastic person, then one has to observe celibacy. So we have three actions of body, four of speech, abstaining from false speech, speaking truthfully, abstaining from divisive speech, speech that creates conflicts between people who are on friendly terms, and instead one speaks words that promote harmony. One abstains from harsh speech and speaks gently and politely, abstains from idle chatter, instead one speaks in moderation and makes sure that one's words are useful, meaningful. So those are four of speech. Then three courses for training the mind to overcome covetousness and be content with what is rightfully one's own. Overcoming ill will and hatred and maintaining goodwill towards beings, all living beings. And then discarding wrong view and holding to right view. Especially in this context, it's the view that affirms karma and its results. Okay, then the next factor, actually, we take the next two together. So this includes assistance to relatives, helping one's relatives, and then blameless actions. And so in this sutta, the Buddha is speaking to his disciple, the householder, not the pindika, and he's explaining the right ways of using wealth that one has acquired. So he says, first, with wealth that one has acquired through right livelihood, one makes oneself happy and pleased. So one doesn't leave oneself out of the picture, but one has to look after oneself, even though we don't want to make ourselves number one above others, but we do have to take care of ourselves. Then one makes one's parents happy and pleased, maintains them in happiness, makes the wife and children, or husband and children, happy and pleased, servants, workers, and helpers happy and pleased, and maintains them in happiness. So that is the first good way of utilizing wealth. Okay, the second, one makes one's friends and companions happy and pleased. Maybe one throws parties for them, provides them with financial help when they're in need, does things together with them, maybe go on outings with them. Okay, then another portion of the wealth one has to reserve. This is like taking out insurance for losses that might come because of fire, floods, kings or bandits, or unloved heirs. And then one makes, they call the five oblations to relatives, guests, ancestors, the taxes to the king, and offerings to the deities. And this is what I love about Indian society, or Indian culture, that, you know, even though Buddhism sort of moves in and takes a dominant role in certain parts, but the Buddha doesn't discard, like, the local deities. Like, you have to continue making the offerings to the local deities, because they, in the popular imagination, they have a role to play in the, call it the broader economy. Like, they are the ones who provide assistance in worldly matters. You know, the Buddha and the great disciples, they provide spiritual guidance on the way to cultivate moral and spiritual life leading to benefits and to liberation. But it's the little sort of local deities that help when your husband is sick and you want him to get well, or the children are trying to get into a particular school and you want to ensure that they get into that school. If you are facing some personal challenge and you want to find a solution to that challenge, there are these multiple deities which are working behind the scenes, and if one shows them the proper respect and makes the oblations to them, you know, they could help. They could be the ones pulling the strings. Even in a country like Sri Lanka, which is predominantly Theravada Buddhist, what I used to notice in the temples where I stayed, like, the main place of worship is what they call the Buddhuge. That's the Buddha, the shrine room, the hall, the Buddha hall. So people will go first to the Buddha hall, will make offerings of incense, flowers, fruits to the Buddha. Then I see them sort of go off a little to the side. I was always curious, they go off to these little, the little, I don't know what to call them, not quite buildings, but they have these little halls off to the side. And then they would come out, and I would be curious, what are those little halls that they're going into? And then I looked, and I saw that these are the shrines, that's the word that I was looking for. They go off these little shrines to the side. And I was wondering, what are these shrines? Then I would look, and I see that they are shrines with the image of the deities. It would be like, I later found out, Vishnu, who's one of the main deities of Hinduism, gets absorbed into popular Buddhism. So Vishnu has a role. There's Kataragama. That is the South Indian god of war. Somehow he's absorbed into Buddhism. Then Lokanatha. Lokanatha, you see, at a past time, Mahayana Buddhism was quite popular in Sri Lanka. There was actually competition between the Theravadins and the Mahayanas. And of course, one of the chief bodhisattvas of Mahayana Buddhism is Avalokiteshvara, who later becomes Kuan Yin in Chinese Buddhism. So Avalokiteshvara survives in Sri Lanka as the deity Lokanatha. Lokanatha means protector of the world. And then a fourth deity is called Saman, who I believe might be a kind of Theravadan adoption of another bodhisattva called Samantabhadra. I'm not sure about that. And then there's the female deity, Patini, who I think also is adopted from Hinduism, and then becomes functions in popular Sri Lankan Buddhism, a little bit the way Kuan Yin functions in Chinese Buddhism. Okay, so I'm going a little bit off track. So it makes the oblations to the deities. And then the fifth is that one establishes an uplifting offering of alms to those ascetics and Brahmins. Again, the Buddha doesn't neglect the Brahmins. These are the Brahmins who are not living the household life, the renunciate Brahmins, those who are dedicated to taming themselves, calming themselves, and training themselves for Nibbana. Okay, then just I took a few other passages which show, you know, how to be engaged in blameless actions. So this text says that the good person is born into the family for the good welfare and happiness of many people. Then the Buddha compares this to just like a great rain cloud appears for the good welfare and happiness of many people, because it pours down the rain that nurtures the crops. So the good person is born for the good welfare and happiness of many people. And then the Buddha compares this good person to the Himalayan mountains. He compares it to the great sal trees. It's a kind of big tree that grows in South Asia. It grows in branches, leaves, and foliage, and shoots, softwood, heartwood. And so in the same way, the family, the head of the family, endowed with faith, helps the people who depend on him grow in faith, virtuous behavior, learning, generosity, and wisdom. Okay, and I would put under blameless actions any kind of actions that we might take to create what I would call a more just, equitable society, to protect the natural environment, to see that people can live together peacefully, and to take actions, say, to oppose military activities, military engagements, as ways of solving problems. So all these actions that are intended to promote the well-being and happiness of all of our fellow citizens and fellow residents of the world, including protecting the lives of animals. And there's an organization actually called Dharma Voices for Animals to protect animal life from cruelty and needless slaughter. So all of these we can take as examples of blameless actions. Okay, maybe we should take a 10-minute break now, and then continue.